Welcome back, WrestleRanders, to WrestleRan Edition number 68. I am your host, Blitch, 4 Feature Comics Level 2, Graham, GSM Matthews, holding the Light Heavyweight Championship belt here today to review Monday Night Raw for August 27, 2012. Fresh off a pretty good episode. I'm not going to say pretty good. I'd say it was pretty decent, too lackluster, but I'm going to break it down for you right now. So to kick off the show, we had Jerry Lawler and WWE Champion CM Punk. Of course, CM Punk's delivering all of his disrespect lines. Everything that happened from last week when CM Punk struck Jerry Lawler in the back of the head. Just talking about that kind of stuff. Strong promo to kick off the show. Really enjoyed it. CM Punk is doing phenomenal in his mic work since reverting back to his heel persona. Jerry Lawler was fine here, as much as I don't like Jerry Lawler as an in-ring performer, as a commentator, whatever. But he did fine here. He played his role well, and it helped effectively promote the main event for later in the evening, as well as deliver a hook for the rest of the show as to whether Jerry Lawler would accept CM Punk's challenge to a main event match later in the night. Moving on, Ryback versus Jack Swagger. This is a match that I wanted to see the night after Money in the Bank. If you can remember, those two had a brief altercation, but however, a match was never followed up between them. But instead, we got the match here tonight. Decent match, about 2 minutes long, longer than I expected it to be. So a good match for what it was worth, easily one of Ryback's better matches since he re-debuted. Swagger is a good worker, as is Ryback, so putting them together makes for good chemistry, a good matchup. Ryback picks the victory over the former World Heavyweight Champion. So Ryback defeating a former World Heavyweight Champion is a pretty big deal. They didn't really put that over on commentary, but especially since Jack Swagger has been losing a lot lately. I guess, as they said, he hasn't won a singles match on Raw, since January 16th, I think, of this year, when he first won the United States Championship. So that's a pretty hell of a long time. He hasn't won a singles match on Raw. So it's pretty predictable that he would be losing here, but a fine match nonetheless. Moving on, Divas match. Divas champion Layla defeating Natalya. Pretty good match. Easily one of the better Divas matches in recent months. Especially given the fact that Layla and Natalya are probably two of the best workers in the Divas division. So putting them together makes for a good matchup. I'm really glad that it made it on Monday Night Raw. We've seen that match a few times on Superstars. And I believe once before on SmackDown, so I was really glad to see it on Raw this week, even though it did last only 2 minutes, which is usually longer than most Divas matches, by the way. But I think the only major issue with this matchup was the fact that Vicky Guerrero was standing at ringside the entire time, and all the focus was on her and her big announcement. So I think that kind of took away from it and made the entire match feel meaningless, but nonetheless, it was a good match, to say the least. Vicky Guerrero's announcement, I don't really understand the whole point of that. It felt a bit meaningless. It felt a bit pointless. Didn't really understand the point of it. But AJ coming down and attacking Vicky Guerrero, that was pretty cool. Smacking Vicky across the face and then just storming off that right after that. That was pretty cool, giving an extra edge to her character that we haven't seen since she took the reins of the general manager of Monday Night Raw. So I was glad to see an extra layer added to AJ's character, especially given the history between AJ and Vicky Guerrero. Moving on, John Cena versus The Miz. Pretty good matchup. We've seen this about 1,000 times. John Cena picked up the victory. So it was a fun matchup. I mean, the outcome was never in doubt. But it makes The Miz, as well as the Intercontinental Championship belt, look weak. Miz has hardly won any non-title matches since he captured the IC title. He's lost matches to Kane. He's lost matches to Rey Mysterio. He's lost tag team matches. But if the title isn't on the line, he will almost guaranteed lose. That's the problem with The Miz right now. They're trying to rebuild him up as a top heel on the roster, but they're not going to be able to do that if he's losing all these consistent matches. I understand that John Cena may have needed the momentum going into his WWE title match in a couple weeks, but The Miz needs to be built up as well if they want him to look like a legitimate IC champion, especially since he proclaimed that he was going to be one of the most decorated IC champions of all time. So he definitely should back that up in the ring by picking up some victories. Moving on, we had Kane and Daniel Bryan in numerous segments throughout the night featuring the anger management classes. This was probably the highlight of the entire show. Hilarious stuff from both D-Bry and Kane. Daniel Bryan, as I've said numerous times in videos and articles, D-Bry since turning heel has been the most entertaining act in WWE. Just continuing to progress and develop his character each week. And this week was no different. Absolutely hilarious in those numerous backstage segments. Or not backstage segments, just the anger management classes. So a lot of good stuff from him. Kane, on the other hand, retelling his story, his life story, that was absolutely hilarious. Mentioning Katie Vick and then Shane McMahon and the Undertaker burials. All that stuff was extremely entertaining. found it was thoroughly enjoyable throughout the entire thing with Kane and D-Bry. I would absolutely love to see Kane and D-Bry form a tag team after this. I know their recent rivals, and it wouldn't make much sense to team them up right now, but given their similar personas, I would absolutely love to see those guys form a tag team. Daniel Bryan could be the talker of the team. Kane could be the, you know, the physique, could be build, the strong guy of the team, and those guys could be extremely entertaining together. Especially after this segment. Hopefully, we see these more of these segments, these anger management classes going forward, because that was absolutely hilarious. And as I said before, the highlight of the show, undoubtedly. Santino Marella versus Heath Slater, absolute throwaway matchup. So we go from the highlight of the show with D-Bry and Kane to the low point of the show with Santino and Heath Slater. Now, I really like Heath Slater. He got a big pop when he came out. Not a huge pop, but he got a pretty mild pop. Definitely a bigger pop than Santino. Who didn't even receive a pop at all, which I was glad to see. So I guess even the kids are getting sick of him now. But, you know, Heath Slater got a face pop when he first came out. And I thought he was going to be winning this match, especially after his tout that said he was after his winning streak that started on SmackDown last week after defeating Sin Cara. So I thought that he'd be winning this week, especially since Santino was distracted by Axon on the stage. But sadly, Santino picked up the victory nonetheless. I mean, I understand the fact that Santino possibly could have needed the victory since he lost in SummerSlam and to Cesaro two previous times before that, but who really cares? Santino's over as hell as it is, so why would you even need him to pick up a victory here? I mean, Heath Slater, I know giving him the victory wouldn't have done much good either, because I know he's not doing anything right now, but it would have made things 10 times better. This thing was an absolute throwaway. Who really cares? Antonio Cesaro, who is the United States champion, who should be appearing on Raw, didn't even appear on this week's episode. He should be appearing on Raw if he wants exposure to get more known with the Raw universe, but they didn't make that call for some reason. They just showed Axana instead. But nonetheless, this is probably, as I said before, the low point of the show and completely unnecessary. Next up, tag team match with Brodus Clay and Sin Cara tag team against the team of Brodus Clay. I'm sorry, against Cody Rhodes and Damian Sandow. Decent tag team match. They're probably the highlight of this. Was the brilliant promos from Cody Rhodes and Damian Sandow before the matchup. Absolutely brilliant. These guys would make a dream team. When Damian Sandow said he finally found someone that he can talk smart with, that was hilarious. Damian Sandow, as I say every single week on Twitter, equals gold. Damian Sandow is the future. If he continues to be built up as such and continues to be built up correctly, I can seriously see him as a main event star in a few years. Cody Rhodes, I hated the fact that they took the pinfall here, but Damian Sandow shouldn't have took the pinfall either, so someone needed to take the pinfall, but the faces have been losing in recent weeks, especially last week, especially after Brodus Clay lost last week, as well as Sin Cara, so they kind of needed the victories here, so having them go over here made sense, but hopefully they continue these feuds going forward, because both of them are enjoyable. I do like the fact that they're both furthering both feuds. D-Bry versus R-Truth. The match was about 2 minutes long, so the action was pretty forgettable. Nothing really to write home about. But obviously, the highlight of the match was D-Bry interactions with fans, you know, saying that he's going to keep under control and trying to stay calm. That was entertaining. And as I said a few moments ago, D-Bry is the most entertaining act in WWE today. So that was obviously a big highlight of this matchup. R-Truth going over the countout didn't really do anything for me, but you know, it was pretty cool on getting D-Bry on television again in a match. So hopefully, being as over as he is, he kept the crowd alive throughout this match. So being as over as he is, hopefully leads to bigger and better things to D-Bry, maybe in the title picture, maybe in a big feud. But hopefully they bring this scenario somewhere and it's not just going to be treading water going forward. Next up, Triple H's promo regarding his retirement was pretty much what you'd expect from him. It felt pretty forced to me, and I know a lot of people felt the same way. You know, because we all know that Triple H isn't retiring. If he was actually retiring, I would have bought the speech, and he probably would have been a little more heartfelt about it. The fake tears, that was a little bit much, trying to make it, you know, as realistic as possible. But we all know that he's not going to be retiring, so why even bother? He's going to be back in 2-3 months tops, so who really cares? The promo was, it lasted about 10-15 minutes, which dragged a little bit for me. It shouldn't obviously been that long, but it was exactly what you expect from Triple H. Hopefully, I mean, I don't know. It was meaningless to me because, you know, we all know that he's going to be back in the next 2-3 months anyway. So, whatever. Moving on, we had Alberto Del Rio tag team with Dolph Ziggler against a tandem of Randy Orton and Sheamus. Pretty good tag team match. Pretty forgettable, though. Nothing really stood out. It was an ordinary tag team match, nothing bad, nothing good, but you know, it was solid for what it was. I like the fact that they're incorporating these SmackDown feuds on Raw. As I just said, with Brodus Clay and Sin Cara and the Cody Rhodes and Damian Sandow feud, all that good stuff. That stuff being featured on Raw and exposing it to the Raw universe and the Raw audience is a very smart move that they want people to tune into SmackDown. So maybe that's the reason why the ratings have gone up in recent weeks. So incorporating those feuds on Raw is a smart move, even though the match was nothing to write home about. It was pretty good for what it was. Before the main event matchup, we had Zack Ryder versus David Otunga. Throwaway matchup, didn't really mean anything, about 2 minutes long. Really glad to see Zack Ryder pick up the victory here, his first singles victory on Raw in God knows how long. But Otunga doesn't really mean anything anyway, so I was kind of glad to see Zack Ryder pick up the victory here. Kane not ambushing Ryder and not burying Zack Ryder was probably the best part about this. The first time Zack Ryder hasn't been buried on Raw in months. So I wouldn't necessarily call this a Kane face turn, because Kane has always been technically considered a tweener anyway, at least in my eyes. So, you know, it was pretty cool to see Kane try to defend Zack Ryder, although it didn't make much sense. But, you know, given the anger management stuff, I guess it did make somewhat sense. But nonetheless, it was good to see Ryder get somewhat of momentum here after being buried for God knows how long in 2012. On top of the main event matchup, CM Punk versus Jerry Lawler. In my opinion, I found this to be pretty boring. I have absolutely no intentions of watching a 62-year-old man in action. I could really care less about Jerry Lawler. I dislike him on commentary. I dislike him in the ring. So I did not want to see him in the main event, especially against CM Punk. But I will give them props. They did make the best out of the steel cage stipulation. CM Punk bled at one point. That was pretty brutal. He was bleeding a lot. He had it all over his tape. He had it all over his face. So that was pretty cool. And they didn't try to wipe it up either. So, but besides that, in that aspect, it was entertaining. It was brutal. But other than that, it was pretty boring, especially since we knew that CM Punk was going over anyway. But, you know, CM Punk defeating a 62-year-old man who happens to be on commentary doesn't do anything for him. But beating down Lawler and making, you know, forcing him to submit rather strongly, as I just said, it makes him look strong, especially puts him over the heel. Especially since Punk will continue to be cheered going forward. I don't see how he can possibly be booed. There's a majority of fans that will continue to cheer Punk. So doing as many heelish tactics as possible will only further that. So I'm glad to see Punk finally looks strong here against Jerry Lawler. And John Cena coming out probably 5 minutes after Jerry Lawler started to get attacked anyway was a bit pointless. But John Cena starting to come out and protect Jerry Lawler, further the feud between him and Punk. So I like that, and especially since AJ announced Punk versus Cena Night of Champions. It was kind of announced in an anticlimactic fashion, but I can get over that. Hopefully they rebuild it next week. But overall, this is a lackluster show, as I said before. Could have done better. It was decent, I will give you that, but it was nothing. It wasn't as good as last week or in weeks previous. It wasn't all that bad. I don't think there was anything on the show that was terrible except for the Santino bullshit. But other than that, I was glad not to see Big Show on the show. I was kind of surprised why he wasn't on the show. Same with Christian. But you know, other than that, I thought this is a decent show. A lot of good feuds that they furthered on here as well. You know, with Brodus Clay and Cody Rhodes. I'm sorry, with Brodus Clay and Damian Sandow, Sin Cara and Cody Rhodes. Punk and Cena, Del Rio and Sheamus. A lot of stuff further on this show that I was glad to see. And as I said before, the highlight of the show, if you missed Raw, the highlight of the show that you want to go back and see is the anger management classes. That was probably the funniest shit on Raw I've seen in a long time. So I really enjoyed that. But other than that, there was nothing really all that great about the show. Hopefully they continue to produce good shows going forward. I don't want to see, you know, it didn't really drag for me. I will say that. This show didn't really drag for me. But hopefully they do try to incorporate less filler going forward. I know it's a 3-hour show, but it didn't drag for me this week. Kind of went by pretty fast. But they do need to use their time effectively and further the feuds like they did tonight. So thanks for watching, guys. Make sure to subscribe. And this is GSM signing out. Till next time, guys.